So thank you very much. So I would like to thank the organizer, and also I would like something to what I said yesterday, that it is a really great thing to have, when you are young, to have Lucky Lucy as advisor and Pierre Deligne nearby. So all what I will say is joint work with Guo Baochao. So I will first recall some fact on equivariant cohomology, which goes back to Atiyah, Siegel and Borel. So I will do it in the algebraic setting. So K is a field with an algebraic closure K bar, and X is a scheme of finite type over K, and then which is equipped with an action of a torus T over K. So then we can we may consider the T equivariant Eladic cohomology. Of X with value in QL, so for some L invertible in K. And so this is a Dirac sum of the same thing with HN. And this is also the cohomology of the stack, algebraic stack, X divided by T. So for example, if X is the point, then it is known that this is this cohomology is an algebra. So what we have is we have H 2n T of this point, of the point with value in QL is the symmetric power, n symmetric power of the character group of the torus. With a T twist minus 1. T and I forget QL. Tensor QL, QL minus 1. Or tensor Z. Okay. And there is no even. There are zero, the even group, so this is for n, all n at least zero. And in fact, there is a, with the cup product, so we get a natural structure of a graded ring on this cohomology, T-equivariant cohomology of the point, which is in fact a polynomial algebra in a certain number of variables, which is the rank of this free Z module. And this is Galois equivariant. So, and this is acting on the equivalent cohomology of any scheme with an action of T. So, and so that means that this equivalent cohomology is a graded module and again it's by the action is by cup product. So this cohomology, so I will say why, but this cohomology group are all finite dimensional, but there are infinitely many of them, as we can see in this basic example. So and the main tool to study equivalent cohomology is the Lorentz spectral sequence for this morphism of stack. So which says the following, that means it goes from E PQ, HQ. So it goes from the ordinary cohomology of X, tensor with the equivalent cohomology of the point. I forget the k bar here. QL, and there is a T here, and it goes to the equivalent cohomology of X. So, and the fact that this cohomology is finite dimensional implies that this module here, I mean, this graded module is of finite type. Well, that's what the basic fact I'm recalling. This graded module is of finite type. So, and in this business of equivalent cohomology, I need this equipment. The equivalent cohomology is especially useful when we have this purity property. That means when this, what is important is to have this spectral sequence to degenerate. And to have this spectral sequence to degenerate, it's automatic if the cohomology, ordinary cohomology of X is pure. So X has pure L-adic cohomology if and only if each HI is pure of I. So this occurs if the variety is proper and smooth, projective and smooth, or proper and smooth. And this is due to the Deligne, obviously, theorem on the Weyl conjecture. But in fact, this property occurs in there other examples, which are very important, like, for example, the classical Springer fiber. And as we will see, the affine Springer fiber should have this property. And so if this property is satisfied, then the spectral sequence degenerates. And we have two properties that we can get from that, is that the restriction map, so there is a restriction map from the equivalent cohomology of X to the equivalent cohomology of the fixed point set of this T action. And then in this case, this is a free module over this polynomial algebra, which is the cohomology of a point, and this map is injective. And so those two objects are module, free module of finite rank over the cohomology of the point, equivalent cohomology of the point, and the kernel, the co-kernel is torsion. And so the second thing that
it is a consequence of the kernel.
It's a consequence of the fact that this spectral sequence degenerate and purity. So there is a localization theorem of Atiyah Siegel behind. But this is why the purity is good for, for which reason the purity is good for. And for the other property is that one can recover. I am not precise here, but there is a precise statement. We can recover the ordinary cohomology from equivariant. So next, I would like to say a few words on affine Springer fibers, which are the variety which are related to the fundamental lemma. So I will consider only those varieties for GLN. So we have a local field. And there I am thinking in terms of local field in equal characteristic. So to get the fundamental lemma in unequal characteristic, there is this very powerful theorem of Walz-Burger, which says that if you know it in equal characteristic, you know it also as well in unequal characteristic. So. Then you can reduce the problem to some geometrical problem. So this is the local field, the basic local field, and then you have to give you an element in some group. So one way to do that is you give you first of all a torus by giving you a finite family of extension. So this is a separable. Finite. So I'm assuming here they are totally ramified. So that is, I have neat statement. And that's it. You can assume the M-theme if you like, but it, for what I am saying, it does not matter. And so then for each of them, you have a uniformizer. You have also the ring of integer. And here you have your the ring of integer OI. And so that gives you, in fact, a torus inside GLN. And I need an element inside this torus. So I am considering the Lie algebra version of the fundamental lemma. Again, by Walz-Burger, it's enough to do the Lie algebra version of the fundamental lemma. So I am giving me some gamma I in such a way that the gamma I generate the extension gamma I. And I make a regularity assumption, which is that the minimal polynomial of gamma I are 2 by 2 relatively prime, or distinct, because they are irreducible. And so, at the end, I have an element in the Lie algebra, in the following Lie algebra, which is topologically nilpotent, regular semisimple. And the corresponding affine Springer fiber, it's very easy to define, it's S gamma. That's a scheme over K, which is the set of points is simply the set of lattices, OF lattices, which are stable by gamma I. So gamma I is gamma I, and this is a collection of the gamma I. And so this scheme is quite complicated. As it is not connected, but it is easy to say what are the connected components. So there is a discrete invariant of a lattice like this, which is the index with respect to a fixed lattice. So the best fixed lattice that we have in this situation is this one. It's not the most usual one, but it is in some sense the best. So this is an integer, and so this integer cut S gamma into a partition of subvarieties, which are in fact the connected component. Moreover, we have an action of a discrete group, lambda I, act on S gamma by the homotacy, so lambda M, I have this uniformizer, so I can do this element, and I can multiply the lattice by this element, so I get a new lattice. And so this action is permuting the S gamma by through the sum. And there is this theorem by Kasdan and Lustig, which says that they were most probably the first to study those varieties, Kasdan and Lustig. And so they prove that it's an algebra, it's a scheme. So theorem, Kasdan and Lustig. And they prove that so this is a scheme. Are the connected component. This scheme is locally of finite type over the K and of finite dimension. And in fact, if you look at the quotient of, so you have a subgroup of lambda which is stabilizing the zero connected component. And if you look at this quotient, this is a projective variety. And moreover, the quotient map is a nice etal, Galois etal covering. With Galois group, this lambda is zero. So you have to think a chain of projective line. This is an example going to this. And lambda I zero is Z, and it acts by translation. So I would like to explain what is the geometric version of the fundamental lemma, which was conjectured by Goreski, Kotwitz, and MacPherson. So in fact, the way I'm doing the things, I am really making geometric Harishchandra descent. But for unitary group, the fundamental lemma and Harishchandra descent are closely connected in some sense. That means geometrically, they are the same statement. For other groups, obviously, it is not the same. So, so the fundamental lemma occurs because you have a partition of I in two pieces. It occurs because you have an endoscopic group in a group. I am not really explaining why you need the fundamental lemma. I'm just saying here in this geometric picture how it occurs. So, and if you have a partition like that, you have also the Springer fiber corresponding to the lattices. In the sum of the extension EI over this set of indices. And so this is contained in S gamma. And in fact, it is a set of lattices which are split. I mean, M equals. So, and I will denote by, so in the, I will look, I will need the intersection with the connected component, so I will give a notation for that. I will put simply a zero. So this is not connected anymore. So you have to think to this chain of projective line, and then you have the point here. And so there is naturally a torus of rank one, which acts on this, and suggests the fixed point set is just this variety. So on the torus, you take just a standard torus. And you let it act on lattices by homotacy again. And so what you have to say is Ti equal 1, equal T if I is in E1, and T1 equal 1 if I is in E2. So and then if you have a torus acting on a variety and a fixed point set, you can look at the restriction map in equivalent cohomology. So it's very tempting to do that, so you do it. And it's why this team of Goreski, Kotwitz, and McPherson are doing. They look at the restriction map in equivariant cohomology. And I put some Q. So this map is, as before, linear under the action of under there is a module structure under the graded algebra, which is the equivalent cohomology of the point. But there is another structure coming from the action of lambda. And so. I mean, this is also the geometric action of lambda, which is translating this chain, translating the P1 on the chain and the point on as well, is acting on both lambda I0 is acting on this connected component and this set. And so you have naturally a map which is linear under these two module structures. So now let me introduce the kappa. So the kappa is a character of this algebra, or the group, if you like, if you prefer, which is given by simply by lambda goes to minus 1 sum of lambda I, which is also equal to minus 1 sum lambda I. And so such a kappa has a kernel, which is a maximal ideal. And so I can now state, I have almost all the things I need to state the geometric fundamental lemma in this particular case of the unitary group. So I need a few more things. I need to have the product of the minimal polynomial of the gamma I for alpha equal 1 and 2. I need the power of the In the Langlands-Schellstad fundamental lemma, there is a transfer factor, and this transfer factor is a product of a sign and a power of Q, and the power of or the number of elements of the residue field. So, yeah, obviously, I'm assuming that K is finite in the, to connect with the fundamental lemma. So. I am not stating the fundamental lemma. I am stating a geometric statement which implies the fundamental lemma. This power of Q is easy to see geometrically. This is R, the valuation of the resultant of these two polynomials. If you have two polynomials in one variable, they have a resultant. And this resultant has a valuation, and this is R. And I will denote, I will identify the cohomology of the pond, the T equivalent cohomology of the pond, to a polynomial algebra in one variable. So T is the first Chern class of the universal line bundle on the classifying group of T, which is the quotient of the pond by T. So now what is the conjecture? So they have a more general conjectural statement for any group. And in some sense, what they explain is really the what is behind the fundamental lemma. So now you have to prove it, but in some sense, it is understood. If you in this picture, the equivalent cohomology picture, so the conjecture of Goreski, Kotwitz, McPherson says the following: assume, they claim that it is pure, so the ordinary cohomology of the affine Springer fiber is pure. So this is the first part of the conjecture. So that the restriction map, the above restriction map, is injective. And moreover, its image of restriction map is T to the R. So this is, in some sense, the geometric transfer factor. Yes, of the fixed pond set. I will not put the T. I will just replace equivariant by bracket T, so that would be nicer. Inside the full polynomial thing. So that means the same thing without the T to the R. So that's a statement. So I don't rewrite everything, but this is a statement. So and if you are able to prove that, then by putting some twisted Frobenius on this picture, I mean you have to fix a quadratic extension of K, you have to put a twisted Frobenius which take into account the fact that you are not working with GLN but with a unitary group, then from this statement it's easy to get the fundamental lemma. So you have to, it's a little bit tricky about the sign, but there is a way, Kotwitz has found a way to normalize the sign, so this complicated Langlands-Schellstad sign can be normalized to be one if you use a constant representative. And this, the constant representative is precisely what I'm doing when I'm taking as a fixed lattice AI. So this corollary of the conjecture, fundamental lemma for unitary group. So in some sense, that's the ideal way to prove the fundamental lemma. First you prove that, and then you get the fundamental lemma. So, and I would like to say a few words about the attempt of Goreski, Kotwitz, and McPherson to prove this conjecture in some cases. So, and this is the famous balloon of this team. So, let's speak about balloons. And why it does not work, unfortunately, why it does not work in general. So let's start again with a general situation. So let X, a variety over K, a quasi-projective variety over K, equipped with a linear action of a torus, any torus, not a torus as before of rank one. And assume that the Eladig cohomology is pure, of X. And let's assume, moreover, that they are only finitely many zero-dimensional orbits and one-dimensional orbit. So this is clearly not the case for the small torus that I have here, because here I have a big, in general, I have a big fixed point set. But let's assume that. Then each orbit, you have for each orbit, you have a starting point in some sense, two end points. So, and you have the fixator, a stabilizer of any point of the orbit, which is some constant subgroup. So I am taking orbit over the algebraic closure. So I get this. And so there is a theorem, which is in their paper, but I don't know if it, most probably it was known earlier from the people in equivalent cohomology, that the equivalent cohomology, in this case, the equivalent cohomology can be computed explicitly. I mean, this is amazing, but it is the case. It means that you can really compute completely the equivalent cohomology of X as a sum module of the polynomial algebra. Which is the cohomology of the fixed point set. So I rewrite the cohomology of the fixed point set as a sum of polynomial algebra. Now the fixed point set is finite. So if I do it, I want to do it in taking account the Galois action, it's a little bit more complicated. So, and what is the answer? What is this sum module? So it's a sub module over this algebra. So this is the cohomology of a point, as before. And so there is a recipe, which is simple. So you view the element in this symmetric algebra as polynomial function on the co-character group of the torus. So, so you have a family of function So an element of this direction is a family of function on the co-character group of the torus with value in QL minus 1. And the only thing, what you require to get the sum module is that when you restrict the function at the origin of one orbit, so for each orbit, one dimensional orbit, and there are finitely many of them by hypothesis. So what you ask is that the restriction to the co-character of the stabilizer of a generic point of the orbit is equal to the same thing for the endpoint. So it's beautiful. There is a beautiful answer for the equivalent cohomology in this case. And so this works in a case where, essentially, the case where it works is where when all the extensions are trivial. So there are two parts in the statement. There is a puritist part, and there is a, here I am assuming that it is pure, but if I apply this, so as Goresky, Kotwitz, and McPherson are doing, to affine Springer fiber. So it's not exactly a finite type, but it doesn't matter. There is a way to do it. So if you apply this statement to affine Springer fiber, you need the purity conjecture. So let's assume first the purity conjecture. Then essentially, the method works when all these extensions are trivial. Or you take the ordinary cohomology. It's a projective limit. Or you take the homology as they are doing if you don't like a projective limit. If you prefer inductive limit, you take the homology. If you it's a matter of taste, but it is the ordinary cohomology. And so this is the restriction because they need a torus with a lot, very few fixed point and one-dimensional orbit. And this is only in this case that you can. So it's a little bit more tricky, but essentially it is this case they can do. And for the purity conjecture, they need, in some sense, an extra assumption that the valuation of the gamma A are all the same. So I don't go into the detail, but from this. By this method, they get the unramified equivalent, the equivaluation case of the unramified fundamental, unramified equivaluated case of the fundamental lemma for any group, in fact. It is not related to unitary group, what they are doing.
What's the balloon here?
Ah, the balloon. Here, there are plenty of balloons, so you just have to make a picture like this. So just a question of, here are the balloon. No, but that means topologies, they like P1 as a projective as S2. And people in algebraic geometry, usually, they just draw a line. That's so the balloon are the one-dimensional orbit. So due to this, but in some sense, this method is doing too much. Because with this method, you can get a completely explicit formula for orbital integrals that you know that they are extremely complicated, and you don't expect, really, in general, to have neat and nice formula for orbital integrals. So they are doing too much in some way. And also, any direct approach to this Goresky, Kotwitz, McPherson seems to be very hard. So the most natural idea is to try to deform the problem to a simpler one. So when you have a problem which is complicated, so you say deform it to a simpler one, then I hope I prove the theorem in a simple case, and then I hope that by some kind of perverse continuation, I can get the case I am interested with. But the main problem is that the Springer fibers, they don't behave well in family. They are really awful in family, so they don't behave well. So the main reason, I think, is that the Springer fibers are local objects. I mean, like local orbital integrals. And what is the things which have a good interpretation in the theory, geometric interpretation in the theory of automorphic form, are the global object. Global orbital integral, all the global things are easy to interpret, but the local things are bad. And so this problem disappears in some sense if one replace the local object by global object. And technically, that means that we'll replace affine Springer fiber by compactified Jacobian. So this is local, this is global. And in fact, what we are doing is to prove, in fact, a global version of the fundamental lemma. If you have local fundamental lemma in the stabilization of the trace formula, and what Kotwitz is doing, for example, in the elliptic case, there are some global integrals, stable orbital integrals, which are occurring. And those are more or less product of local orbital integral. And in some sense, there is a fundamental global fundamental lemma, which is more or less a product of local fundamental lemma. And this is really the global things which is nice to prove, or at least provable in general. So, and the key idea is very simple. I mean, there is nothing really deep there. You just look at this ring. And so, first of all, to have a lattice, so this ring has a fraction field, which is EI, and to have a lattice which is stable by M, by gamma I, this is the same than to have a AI sum module. And the AI sum module of a fraction field, that means the rank one, torsion-free module over AI, with some rigidification on the generic point. So that means an affine Springer fiber is the same than, in some sense, a local compactified Jacobian, a moduli space, a torsion-free, rank one torsion-free module. Now, to go to the global, so the remark is that this is, in fact, a germ of curve. It's like if you have two variables and you divide by one equation. So it's a germ of plane curve. And so you are in the situation, the geometrical situation, which is very good. So globally, what you will the most natural idea is to replace the local germ of curve by a curve. That means we have a local germ of curve. So the branches are indexed by I. So it's in the and the coordinates are t and okay. It goes through the origin, but so and you replace this by a global curve. That means you do a global things with maybe several branches, but a connected things. Even an my picture is not good. Okay, I didn't prepare enough for the picture, so. You make something global like this. And if you have a global curve, so the compactified Picard scheme, which has been studied by Altman and Kleiman, so this is the moduli space, moduli stack, of OY module, coherent, wiring module, which are free, torsion free of generic rank one. And these things, so if you have a curve, you have a normalization, I mean a smooth curve, which has a above y. And this is essentially the product of the Jacobian, the Picard scheme of the normalization, times for each singular point a Springer fiber, affine Springer fiber, a local compactified Jacobian. And if you count points, you have a global orbital integral, in fact a stable one in general, which is equal to a volume time some local orbital integrals. So, okay, so that was the things at some point. And then Ngo came with this marvelous idea to say, okay, he was thinking, okay, we can try to produce curve in an artificial way. And Gore, at least, he has maybe more memory than I have. He remembers that there is a beautiful family of compactified Jacobian, which is given by the chain vibration. I mean, starting from a local thing, you can globalize it as you like. I mean, there is no preferred way to normalize. But if you do the things like this, it is not at all related to group theory. Now, in group theory, in some sense, you have a beautiful family of compactified Jacobian, so which is given by the Hitchin vibration. And this is what I would like to explain now. So again, I am doing the things for GLN, but it can be done for other groups. So we have to fix a global field. So we started with a local field, so now we fix a global field. So to fix a global field, the best is to fix a projective smooth projective curve, geometrically connected over the finite field, which is my K I started with. So for the Hitchin vibration, we need also an ample divisor. Okay, it's okay. Effective. An ample effective divisor. And then we have Hitchin has defined a stack, the Hitchin stack, which is a stack of pairs of rank n vector bundle on X and a twisted endomorphism, so theta. Belongs to is a map from E to E twisted by D. So you twist by D because otherwise you have something which is too small. So and in fact there is a beautiful Adelic interpretation of all this business. And you fix the D because if you don't fix the D, you will end with elements which are at the same time rational and integral everywhere. So that means you have very few of them. But if you allow poles somewhere, you have more of them. So this D is a way to allow poles. So you have this beautiful stack. And there is even a more beautiful map, which was also founded by Hitchin, which is very simple to understand. You just take the characteristic polynomial of theta. So and this is H0, sorry. I equal 1 to n, and f of theta is a characteristic polynomial of theta. N is GLN, I have fixed some n, which is GLN. I am working with GLN, so n is the degree of, if you want to compare with what I have done before. Well, that's
problem with the paper.
So let me recall a few things about this, what Itchin did, has done. Very few. So, and to have a link with compactified Jacobian, so. In fact, once you have a characteristic polynomial, you can associate to it what Itchin called a spectral curve. So this is a curve with equation u to the n plus a1 u n minus 1 plus an. And it lives inside the total space of the line bundle Oxd. And this is Ya. And so this is a ramified cover of degree n of x. And so the Itchin vibration is complicated. For example, if A is zero, then you get the nilpotent cone, as Gerd Faltings explained. But if you take an A which is reasonable, that means for this purpose, that means if you take an A such that YA is reduced, is a reduced curve, then there is this theorem, which is due to Itchin if YA is smooth, and to Boville, Narasimhan, Ramanan in general, that the fiber of the Itchin vibration are the compactified Jacobian of the spectral curve. So, and this is an easy exercise to prove that. Beautiful exercise. So Itchin for A when YA is smooth, and more generally Boville, Narasimhan, Ramanan. So now what is the relation with the fundamental lemma? So we have the M and the A. But we also have something related to my partition I divided in I1 and I2. So here I will simply say that I will decompose n in n1 plus n2. And then you have the b and the n. So that's the Itchin vibration for GLN, and that's the Itchin vibration for GLN1 times GLN2. So and the link between the two is that if you have PA1 and PA2, you can multiply them and you get a PA. So this is the space of A1, A2, and you get an A. And if you have a spectral curve, YA1 and YA2, you can do the sum as a Cartier divisor, and you get YA. So you have, in the vector bundle, you have a curve with two irreducible components for simplicity, but in fact it can be more complicated. But at least a splitting into two pieces. And so this picture can be restricted to the radius set, where this polynomial are, these curves are reduced. And so, and then we have on the radius set, I just restrict everything to the radius set here. So then I have, and then I do the base change, so I get something like that. Well, first of all, I put reduced everywhere. So here, this is the intersection of B with the reduced set here. So that means YA is irreducible. And then I have this picture. And then it is easy to introduce a new torus of dimension one, the same as before. I mean, as Goreski, Kotwitz, and McPherson were using. I mean, you take a torus which would give you the gluing. I mean, if on such a curve, you have a natural line bundle associated to an element, to a scalar. What you do is you take a trivial line bundle here, a trivial line bundle there, and then you glue them at those points by the transition function, which is the multiplication by a scalar. So that gives you a torus, T. And this is exactly the fixed point set here. So then you can formulate exactly in the same way that they were doing a relative conjecture of Goreski, Kotwitz, and McPherson. I mean something relative. I mean you just replace the absolute equivalent cohomology by the relative equivalent cohomology for those two maps. Then you have a you can take the relative equivalent cohomology there. You can restrict it to the fixed point set. And then if you have some relative purity, then you are done. And then you can apply this procedure. And no, you are not done, sorry. You have the restriction map in the relative situation. You have a relative statement for the purity. Some conjecture to prove, and then you have to prove that the image of the restriction map is a good one. But here you have two advantages. So first of all, this is not quite true with GLN, but it's true if you replace GLN by a global unitary group scheme. This map is in some sense a proper map between a smooth variety, between two smooth varieties. Then by the line again, you get the purity. So it's not exactly the purity that you need, but this is really the point. Second, here you have a beautiful open subset here, where the two curves, YA1 and YA2, meet transversally, that means that you are reduced to the fundamental lemma for SL2 in the easiest possible case when the valuation of the element is 1. And then Labès and Langlands, they did that a long time ago, and this is even the easiest case of what they have done. So, generically...
Can I clarify one point? You said this geometric statement implies a fundamental lemma, but is it equivalent to that?
No, I don't say that. No, I don't say that. I say that you can at least what I am saying now is that you can prove easily this global conjecture over the open subset where the curve meets transversally. And then you have this purity, in some sense, not for free, because Pierre worked a lot on it, but you have it now. And moreover, you have this decomposition theorem, which is also a consequence of the purity. So putting all these things together, you see that the global relative statement is a consequence of what happened on the open set by perverse continuation, by using perverse sheaf, middle extension, and so on. So then you get the relative statement. So I should say that the relative statement does not imply their precise conjecture that they were doing, but it implies at least the fundamental lemma. We are unable to prove, so I need to answer a part of your question, we are unable to prove their conjecture, but we are able to prove the fundamental lemma. No, but in this case, we do the same arguments that they are doing by geometry. But their argument can be easily reproduced geometrically. We really need the geometric version of it. Now, the fact that it is equivalent, it's like if you say, it's quite a problem which it's not true, in fact. It's not because the traces of Frobenius on two sheaves are equal if the sheaf are not irreducible local systems, that you can deduce that they are equal. So, and that's more or less what we are doing. Okay. Okay, so this picture, This picture, in principle, I mean, this picture is valid for any reductive group. Except that you don't have this map as easily. I mean, our method up to now is able to do the following cases of the fundamental lemma. It's not written, but I think it's more or less obvious that you have... In the fundamental lemma, you have a group and an endoscopic group. So an endoscopic group, it's things which is very complicated. It is not at all a subgroup of the group you start with. But sometimes, it can be a subgroup, but this is not even the point. It can be a subgroup geometrically. That means after a finite, an unramified extension of the base field. And if it is geometrically a Lewy subgroup, then that means the fundamental lemma is just a geometric version of the descent, Harish-Chandra descent. Harish-Chandra descent is easy to prove. The problem is that when you prove Harish-Chandra descent in the easy way, you have to choose a parabolic subgroup for the given Lewy. And in practice, there is no choice like this, which is stable by the Frobenius. So the equivalent cohomology gives you a way to turn around this problem. You don't have to choose a parabolic subgroup. So geometrically, if the fundamental lemma is geometrically Harish-Chandra descent, you are done. So, but there are some cases where it is not like this. And so Ngo is fighting with that now. So I don't know what will be done. I don't know. No, but it was already used. If you look at local Langlands for piadic, I mean, the proof, that means you have to prove that you have a bijection between two sets. So you construct an injective map and you have to prove that it is bijective. And as far as I know, there is no other proof that using this technique, going from piadic to local field of power series, and then going to global. So either by the work that we have done with Rapoport and Stuhler, or by this Fourier transform and this business, and an idea of cash dump. So it is there also, and I think it's there. But obviously, for global question over number fields, there is no. It's just for local questions. There is no doubt that it is very powerful.